Good morning. Let's all stand. Turn to number 660. Number 660. If you need a hymnal, let's sing this together. I will serve thee because I love thee. Sing it with me. Lift out together. Now sing it. I will serve thee.
Saved this morning on the way to heaven, say amen. 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 You may be seated. Thank you so much for being here. We are honored today to have Brother Keith Shoemaker. Brother Keith, raise your hand. And got two of your young people with us, Isaac and Emily. Raise your hand if you don't mind. We're not going to embarrass you, come to you. But we're glad to have you with us. And I'm glad that you're here. But in just a moment, we're going to see a video from Brother Keith, and he's going to start open up our services for us. But Brother Keith's one of the missionaries that we support and is doing an absolute fabulous job in Burkina Faso. And this gentleman that you see, he would never say it, but sometimes in mission work, and especially different parts of the world, it's not that easy. Brother Keith, how many times have you fought malaria now?
Probably 35.
You say, well, that doesn't sound like a big deal. You've never had malaria. Malaria is a very intense, put you on your back, want to go to heaven disease. And so when we mention that, I don't mean to embarrass you at all, Brother Keith, but the caliber of man that you see before you today is a caliber of man that has not allowed anything to stop him from serving and doing what God wants him to do. Amen? And now his your wife's at home with Meredith, and she's not feeling well, was sick all night last night, so we want to remember them. But Brother Keith, it is a joy and an honor to have you. He stays so booked, came back for a short furlough, is leaving. I believe you're going back to Burkina on Wednesday, correct? Going back on Wednesday, so we want to remember that. But tonight we have our quarterly business meeting and also Brother Stephen Underwood's last service. And if you can be here tonight to be there for that, but also to pray with Brother Stephen, he will be leaving for South Africa on Tuesday. We're going to meet him at the airport around 6, take some of his bags down there for him. And so please also keep the Underwood family in your prayers. I'm going to pray, and then, gentlemen, if you don't mind, would you start the video for Brother Keith Shoemaker? Father, we love you. Thank you for the privilege it is to be in the house of the Lord today. I pray, Lord, that you bless and meet needs and hearts and lives. Father, we know that the devil is a roaring lion that roameth about, seeking whom he may devour. But I am so grateful this morning that the lion of the tribe of Judah has defeated the lion of hell. I thank you, Father, that we don't work for victory today, that we work from the victory of Christ. And I pray, Father, today that you would stir our hearts, challenge our hearts. We know, Father, that time is drawing nigh for the return of Jesus Christ. And I pray, Father, that we as individuals, that we'd be found ready. I thank you for the Shoemaker family. I thank you for their labor of love. I thank you, Father, for how they sacrificially just try to get the gospel of Jesus Christ to Burkina Faso and to the world. I pray that you bless them real good today. I pray that you take each and every life and you'd have your hand upon them. Father, we think of the Stapp family and the homegoing of Brother Thurman's sister. And we pray, God, that you would continue to give them sweet grace and, Lord, just a divine awareness of your presence. I'm grateful, for God, that no matter what situation has entered the house of God today, that there's a God in heaven that's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think. Thank you, God, that you sit on a throne and no one is going to take you from it. Bless this service for your glory. If we ask all this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.
Every day, many of you wake up and go to the sink and turn a knob, and water comes out. but that isn't the case for many in this world. This story started a long time ago for the villagers in Yim Toko, but God placed us in their lives in May of 2014. I was invited by Pastor Salif to come to this village and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to these precious souls. This village is a very remote village. The closest small town is about 14 miles away. There is no road but a few dirt paths. There is no electricity or running water anywhere near this place. The day finally arrived for us to go to the village. The villagers were excited by our arrival. Many of them had already gathered together waiting on us. I was the first white man to ever visit this village. As the darkness approached, there were over 200 people that came out. We showed a gospel film, and then I stood up and preached the gospel to them. Something that night happened that we have never experienced before. When we gave the invitation, almost everybody came forward and made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. Knowing that we couldn't leave these new believers without a preacher, four of us began taking turns every week to go out there and preach the gospel to these people. After a few months, we held our first baptismal service. 35 people were baptized by the grace of God. Just after finishing the film that night, one of the men of the villages showed me their drinking water. When I looked at the water, I thought it was a drink that they make with millet, and it makes the water kind of a cloudy color. And they said, no, that's our water. That's what we drink. I didn't believe them. And then one of the men took a cup and dipped it in the water. And when he dipped it in the water, I began to realize that it was dirt that was in the water. I found out that the women travel around 5 miles each day with a donkey and cart to fill up their jugs to get this nasty drinking water. I contacted a group called Friends in Action. They're a group of Christian men that have teamed together to drill wells in needy areas in the country of Burkina Faso. They are not just a social group, but their goal and passion is to assist local churches and church planters to reach others by giving them a great testimony in the area. They asked us to raise money for one well, and they would raise money and give us a second well. While working with them, I was extremely touched by their compassion and love for the Lord and also for the lost souls. I sent out a prayer letter and mentioned this great need. Cherry Grove Baptist Church decided to raise some of the money with their Vacation Bible School. Much to my surprise, they raised all the money necessary to dig the well. Finally, after a few months of preparing and getting everything organized, the team came and arrived. They arrived in the city of Pisila. We led them in the dark that night, 14 miles. It took us over 3 hours to get there. The next morning, we woke up early and we got started. I never realized the work that it takes to dig a well. We attached rod after rod and went deeper and deeper into the ground. Dust was flying everywhere for many hours, and then all of a sudden the dust began to die down, and there was a little moisture in the rock that started coming out. Then it happened, all of a sudden water began shooting out everywhere. After finishing the well, an older man came up to me and said, I thought we could never have water in this village. I didn't fully understand what he was saying until one of our pastors went out there the Sunday after we dug, and he came back and told me what the women had told him. They have tried on multiple occasions to hand dig wells, but have never hit water. They have had other trucks and groups come and try and dig for water with their machines, but they have never hit water. They sacrifice chickens and goats over the spot to their gods, but they never got water. But then they said, we came and we got on our knees and we prayed to the God of heaven that his wills will be done. And after a few short hours, guess what happened? Water began to flow. This is a testimony from the chief in the village. I want to thank you very much for coming to our village. Your arrival in the village has changed our lives. Before, we didn't have good water to drink. We want to thank God for what he has done. Now we don't have any more problems with water. All of the men, women, and children have come out to express their gratitude for what you have done. Before, we had sacrificed to our gods, but we never found water. We are overjoyed, and we want to thank you and the Lord for what he has done. As stated earlier, Friends in Action allows us to have two wells for the price of one. And so we decided to dig the second well in the small market town called Pisila. Pastor Salif started this church there 3 years ago. We purchased 5 acres of land. It was our goal that Pisila would become the hub for the region. We've already started the church there in the Bible college on this land. We're already touching 4 villages near Pisila with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We knew that we needed to have water on the land in order to achieve what God has called us to do. The first hole that we dug didn't provide enough water, so we decided to change locations and dig a second hole. By God's grace, we hit lots of water. Lots of people had gathered around that next morning with their jugs and their barrels, hoping that we could provide them with some water. But what was joyous for us was we were able to gather them together and explain to them about the Bible story of the woman at the well. That morning we had about 20 or more that made professions of faith in Jesus Christ. Many of them came looking for the water that will leave them thirsty, but they found the living water that satisfies them for an eternity.
We just wanted to come by and thank you for your support for many years now. Things that you saw in that video and the things that the Lord has done, you have had a part in that. I've come to realize more and more as the years go on, you know, it's not our work, it's not my work, it's God's work. And in order to accomplish God's work, I think God wanted it this way. He wanted a whole lot of people to be a part of it so no one could get the glory but Him. And he does get all the glory, and he is wonderful. I want to tell you another story. There was one of the villages that we went into in 2005 when we first arrived in Burkina Faso. We started out there, and we were met under a mango tree the first time we went into this particular village. They had never heard the truth, never had anyone go by there, never preached the gospel to them. But we had under a mango tree, one of the villagers had invited us out because he was in the city, and he wanted us to go back and preach the gospel to his people. And so we had a crowd of probably about 200 or so, good crowd of people that were there and preached the gospel. And by God's grace, we had a few make a commitments and trust in Christ that day. Went back about 2 weeks later, and that's kind of the way we did it for many years. Actually, for about 4 years, we'd go out there every other Saturday. And then finally in 2009, we had a pastor who would go out there on Saturday evenings and Sunday mornings and then come back to the city. And God's just done a great work out in that area. But the chief had come maybe to a couple of services. We'd also went by his place a few times, giving him the gospel. But every time we'd get done giving the gospel to the chief, he'd always say, "We're so glad you're here and so glad what God's doing, and so glad the people have a place to go to church." And basically he said, "You have full liberty to do what you need to and what you want to." And so we were excited about what God had been doing, but we heard a few years ago the chief had become very, very sick. And so we knew we wanted to give him the gospel at least one last time. And so we had been out there for a service, and we went to where the chief lives, and he was out in sitting in one of their chairs. They kind of got it in a reclining type of position, but it's just made with sticks. And he was sitting there, and his eyes were he couldn't see very well at this time, They said he couldn't even get up from the chair without help, and he was just in a very, very bad shape. They said he was over 100 years old. Don't really know how old he was. He doesn't really know exactly how old he was, but you could tell he had been a lot of years here on this earth. But we arrived and sat down and began to talk again and share with the chief Christ one last time. And the chief, when we got done, began to give us the same kind of story. "So glad you're here. Just you know, we're just so glad that God has brought you here and everything else." And so one of the pastors that I was with, he kind of cut in on the chief. You don't normally do that, especially to a chief, but he kind of cut in. And he said to the chief, he said, "Chief," he said, "you and I both know you don't have much longer here to live on this earth." He said, "You said the gospel is good for everybody else, but what about you?" And that chief put his head down and began to think for about 5 or 10 seconds, lifted up his head and said, "If it's good enough for everybody else, then it's good enough for me." And a couple minutes later, he bowed his head, confessed Christ, and he told me a story. He said, "When I became a young man," he said, I became chief of this village. He said, "When I became chief of this village," he said, "I would hear these stories. Every once in a while, you hear a story of a man that would come from another country and he'd carry a book. And he'd open up that book and he'd give a message from that book. And he said that book and that message would transform lives." And he said, "I looked up into the heavens and I said, God, would you please send us a man with the book?" He said, "In 2005, you got out of the car and you began to greet us just like we always greet here in Burkina Faso." He said, "But then you went back to the car," and he said, "you got the book and you came out and you delivered the message." And he said, "That message has changed lives and it's changed my life." Boy, sometimes people will say it's a sacrifice in what we do, and maybe it is a sacrifice when you talk about giving up things on this earth. But boy, I tell you, when you hear a story like that, boy, it's not a sacrifice, it's a privilege. Amen. To serve our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's a great honor and a great blessing. I'm hearing as I go around to many churches, I'll hear a lot of people say, I'm just waiting for the Lord to come back. I'm afraid that's the attitude of a lot of churches, and there's nothing wrong. The Bible says that we ought to look for His appearing. But a lot of people, the reason why they want the Lord to come back is they want the Lord to get them out of their mess. They want the Lord to get them out of their financial problems or their family problems or maybe their health problems. But I'm not really sure that's the reason for the Lord to come back. Can you imagine? I've got four children, but can you imagine if I look at the floor and I saw the floor was dirty, and so I asked my daughter. I said, "Can you please take and sweep the floor and clean the floor? And I'll be back in a few hours, and I expect it to be clean." And I see the dishes are dirty in the sink, and I said, "Hey, you know what? Those dishes are dirty, and why don't you take and clean those dishes? And I'll be back in just a short time, but I expect those to be done when I come back." And then I look, and the windows are dirty, and so I say to my son, "Will you please take some Windex and clean off those windows and clean those, and I'll be back in a short time." And I come back and the floor is still dirty, and the dishes are still dirty, and the windows are still dirty. And I say to my children, what in the world, what would you do when I was gone? And I said, "We were just waiting on you to come back." There are so many Christians that's like they're waiting for the Lord to come back, but they're really not ready. The one that's ready is the one that's working as hard as he can, being obedient to God's will and to what he's given us in the Bible to accomplish. What you are doing, and I've been so touched this morning by your friendliness and been so touched by, I know what you're doing in missions, and just it's not the time for the church to bow down. As we see, maybe the day's approaching, and if we thought Christ was coming back as soon, we ought to motivate us, it ought to move us to do more, not less. Well, I tell you, there's such a great work to be done all across this world. God is good, and God is wonderful. Thank you so much for your support. Thank you for your care. We've known Pastor for a long time. I was in his church, I believe, in 1999 down in Valdosta when he pastored down there. And I tell you, God's been good. And so we just love you and appreciate you. God bless you. Let's stand, please. Turn to number 500. Number 500. Let's sing this together. Saved is saved. Lift it up, sing it now.
I found a friend who is all to me. His love is ever true. I love to tell how he lives.
in the blood. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I appreciate everybody being here this morning. Visitors that are with us, we appreciate you being here today. We come to this time in our offering and this time in our service, and we give back to the Lord as He so greatly blessed us. And I am so thankful this morning to be a part of a church that loves to give, that it's their desire to be a blessing to others. And I was telling our teenagers this morning, Brother Keith was back there in our teen group this morning, and I appreciate the message that he gave us on Shammah this morning, and how he stood in that lentil field, and how he didn't back down, and how he stood right in the middle of the fight, and that he didn't get on the sidelines. He stood right in the middle, and how these young people are going to stand right in the middle of that fight and stand for the Lord. And I appreciate that very much, Brother Keith. Thank you for bringing that to us. Now, I was telling our teenagers, I just thank God so much that I'm in a church that just doesn't have a token missionary program. They have a real, vibrant missionary program that we love, and that we don't just have some missionaries, but we pray for folks around this world that they'd be saved and lives be changed, and we can be a part of these great families that are going out and doing this as a part of our ministry. And I'm glad that you can be a part of that. I know that you are. Thank you so much for your giving. As Brother Kenny comes this morning and asks the Lord to bless our offering for us this morning, let's ask the Lord as He would do so. Thank you.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're just thankful to be in your house, Lord, that we can worship you, Lord, in truth. And Father, I just ask that you be with the missionaries around this world, Lord, that are bringing your word. Father, prepare the hearts that they're bringing them to, Lord, that they would open up and just receive you. Father, we thank you for this time that we can come together to just give back to you what you've given to us, Father. And we ask your blessings upon this offering, Lord, that it further your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
School, I learned this simple truth. Jesus died to take my sin away, and I can still remember when He changed my life way back then, and the cross is just as real to me today. I still believe in the power of the blood Jesus shed on the Calvary. And I still hold to the hope that He's gone to prepare a dwelling place.
Number 323, keep singing about that cross. At the cross, alas, and did my Savior bleed. Number 323, lift it up now. Let me hear you sing out on that first verse together.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed. Did my sovereign die? Would He devote sacred head? Such a worm as I. At the cross where I first saw the light, on my
shake hands with one another. Verse together, but drops of grief, sing it.
But drops of grief ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Dear Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross, and the burden of my heart rolled away. My sight, and now I am happy all the day.
You may be seated.
You know, sometimes I just get overwhelmed thinking about how good the Lord is and how faithful He's been. And how faithful He will be, how faithful He always will be. And I don't know if I'll make it through the song or not, but I'm telling you, I could not get away from it as we were singing about the cross. Man, to be faithful enough to go that far for somebody like me. And you say, amen, for somebody like you. It's amazing. But He's been faithful. Amen.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love He's proved faithful to me. Every word He's promised is true. What I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, His love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I may have questioned, even failed to believe, yet He's been faithful, faithful to me. When my heart looked away, the many times I could not pray, still my my God, he was faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly, reaching out for what pleased me, even then he was faithful to me. Every time I come back to him, he is waiting with those open arms, and I see once again he's been faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned and even failed to believe, yet he's been faithful to me. Though in my heart I have questioned and even failed to believe, yet he's been faithful to me.
Amen. Well, I mean, glad he's been faithful, amen. Take your Bibles to the book of Romans, Romans chapter 13, your outlines are in your bulletins. We're going to finish up this chapter today, verses 1 through 7. We learn how to show respect to our civil authorities, and that means we pray for them. We may not always agree with them, but they are in a position that demands a Christian's respect, prayers, honor. There's a way that we ought to treat those that are in authority. If you're with that, say amen. Young people, are you listening? I didn't hear one of you young people on the front row say amen.
Amen.
Thank you, young people. You say, why do you do that? Listen, we got a country that nobody, if we're not careful, they're letting the young people just run amok when it comes to authority. And so, Mom and Dad, that starts at home. You need to say yes. All the parents say yes with me. One, two, three.
Yes.
And all the parents need to learn how to say no. One, two, three. And make sure you say yes on the things that should be yes, and make sure that you say no on the things that need to be no. But your kids need to hear yes, and your kids need to hear no. Your kids need your direction. They need your leadership. They need you to bring them to the house of God. They need you to be faithful to the house of God. If your child turns out to be the kind of Christian you are, what kind of Christian will they be? Just stick with me. If your child turns out to be the kind of Christian that you are, what kind of Christian will they be? And if you don't show them the priority of the house of God, if you don't show them the priority of the things of God, it's a bad enough battle as it is. It's tough enough as it is. But you go ahead and play milk toast on this thing of raising the young people and keeping the things of God before them and keeping the things of Christ before them. If you don't keep it before them, I will assure you, the devil in hell will make sure everything that he wants in front of them is there. Are y'all with me? So Mom and Dad, you can be in the house of God, bring them to the house of God, teach them the house of God, be right, do right, and that doesn't guarantee the end. If you're sitting here this morning and you want to feel all up in your judgmentalness, there's a lot of folks that have raised the kids right, loved the kids right, done right. I think of one that was the greatest parent that anybody could ever have. And his two children turned out to be juvenile delinquents. He was the greatest parent anybody could have, and his kids turned out to be juvenile delinquents. You want to know his name? His name is God. And he had two kids, and he told them and showed them how to do right. And those two kids decided to do wrong. And so it's a bad enough warfare out there for you to raise your kids right and to do right and put a right example in front of them. You're not guaranteed that they're going to do right. God's kids didn't do right. So if by chance this morning you all in your uppity judgmentalness, you need to get out of it. Because it's only by the grace of God that any of us do right, anybody turns out right, anything goes right. It's only by the good grace of God. And you all up in your judgmental this morning, you need to go and delete that. It's only by the grace of God. Are y'all with me this morning?
Yeah.
Authority. Kids need to know what authority is. They need to know authority. They need to hear yes, they need to hear no. They need to hear right, they need to hear wrong. I'm just going to leave my kids to raise themselves. You're going to give account to God for that one day. God didn't give you your kids for your kids to raise themselves. God gave you your children for you to raise up your children. God said, I've got to tell Abraham what's going on because I know he's going to instruct his family well. Y'all with me? Brother Doug, we ought to respect authority. Love it. May not always agree with it. Love it. Respect it. Honor it. That's what the first seven verses are about. Now look at your outlines. Verses 8 through 10, love renewed. First one is learning respect. Number two, love renewed. Attitude as a citizen. We should have an attitude of love toward one another. If you think you're going to come to a Baptist church and everybody's going to like each other, you're at the wrong Baptist church. And by the way, I've got Methodist tithes. If you go to a Methodist church, you're going to find the same quandary. Baptists can't like everybody because how many of y'all woke up this morning shaving, looking yourself in the mirror and go, I don't like that guy, and it was you. Man, we don't even like ourselves. So if you're sitting here this morning thinking kumbaya, warm, fuzzy feeling, everybody's going to like everybody, that doesn't happen. You say, well, preacher, you get on my nerves sometimes. Well, I understand that. I get on my nerves sometimes, so we're easy. But it's going to bust your bubble to realize that there's some folks in this church you get on their nerves. People are funny. They think they're the only ones that's right. You're not. Neither am I. Listen, this is a good chapter. You think we're going to get out by 12? You probably missed it this morning. Missionary took too much time. It's his problem today. Oh, man. I got to be nice to Brother Keith, though. That's a big dude walking through the church. Amen. But love renewed. You need to love each other. Loving each other does not mean condoning sin. Loving each other does not mean condoning sin. Loving each other does not mean condoning sin. You can love the sinner without condoning the sin. If I'm an alcoholic and I put out there for all the world to see that I'm an alcoholic, are you going to say congratulations? If I'm a meth addict and I put out for all the world to see that I'm a meth addict, are you going to say congratulations? We don't take sin and we don't put congratulations on it. Dear Lord, we hurt for it. It breaks our hearts. It drives us to prayer. It makes us want to just hug on people and love on families. But we got to stand against sin, amen. And some people have the mindset that when it comes to standing against sin, that it means hating the sinner. And some people think that if we just love on the sinner, then we got to condone their sin. Do not condone sin. Do not support sin. Do not support a lifestyle that God is going to judge. Don't support that. Amen. But boy, you love them to death. Love them to death. Pray for repentance. Pray that God would draw them back. Pray that sweet word of God that's been hid within their heart would stir and churn within them. Amen. That prodigal son got caught up in a pig pen, didn't he? Got caught up in a pig pen. And when he came to himself, the Bible says that he said, I have sinned against heaven. The first thing he says, I've sinned against heaven. Pray that people would come back to Christ. Pray they would come back to the Word of God. Pray they would get their lives right. Pray that they would repent. Amen. We don't celebrate sin. But oh my soul, may God enlarge our hearts to love those that have been duped and lied to and deceived by the devil. Are you with me? Amen. And so love renewed. May God baptize our hearts this morning with just a fresh fervor of sweet, holy love for everybody. But may there be a understanding that though I love you, oh, I can never biblically celebrate any decision that is contrary to God's holy word, amen. And so that's love renewed. Then look, verses 11 through 14. The Lord's return is your outline. The Lord's return, His attitude toward Christ. And we're starting in verse 11. Would you read with me? Verse 11, he says, "And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed." Verse 12, "The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in envy and strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." Child of God, Jesus Christ is coming again. And Paul is warning them, and Paul is beckoning them to pay attention to the hour that we're in. Because if you're sitting here this morning and you're thinking that you have plenty of time to be saved, then you don't. Please understand this, if you are without Jesus Christ as your Savior this morning, there's no guarantee of this evening, there's no guarantee of this afternoon, there's no guarantee of the culmination of this service. There's no guarantee of an invitation at the end. Look at me this morning, there's no guarantee at all. Jesus Christ, while I am speaking, in oh, blessed time it will be, Jesus Christ will part the eastern sky with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. Jesus Christ will draw us out of here and we're gone, amen. And when that happens, if you've heard about Jesus Christ and you're thinking then you'll make your decision, the Bible says nay. The Bible says, no, dear child, you will not make that decision. Because if you've heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and have refused the Lord Jesus Christ, at the coming of Christ, from that point on through the tribulation time, you will believe a delusion. The Bible says you will believe a lie. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of decision for your life and for mine. Today is a day that God is working in your heart and mine. Today is a day that God wants to draw you with His bands of love. Today is a day that God wants to wash you in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Today is that day, amen, because tomorrow may not come. And He says to them, He says, look at verse 11 with me, "And that knowing the time," the chaos in society, the mess of America, the thing that's going on, I fear we have seen so much filth, perversity, and ungodliness that we have absolutely sucked it to our bosom and we've called it our friend. We do not know right from wrong, evil from righteousness. There is not that which is of God and that which is not of God. There is societal thinking. There is that which has been accepted by institutions, that which has been accepted by our newspapers, that which is put out on our social media. We have taken and been inundated with information from all of these sources, and we have negated ourselves of a full volume of God's holy word. And so we don't know right from wrong, and so we'll celebrate sin, and so we'll ease off of ungodliness, and we'll live a life of apathy and laziness toward the things of God. We'll spend our money and everything that's going to burn up with the return of Christ and not invest it in things such as mission. I mean, we'll look from our checkbook to our life book to our Bible. We'll look through all of these things, and we find that our life is consumed with everything that does not matter. We have time to go through a ball game, time to go on a fishing trip, time to go camping, time to do anything. And you know me, you know there's nothing wrong with that. But we seem not to have time to witness. We seem not to have time to read our Bible. We seem not to have a time for that hour of prayer. Sister Maggie, that old school times, we'd get on our face before God and go around in a circle and beseech and cry out to God, and mascara would run and men would tremble under God's power, wanting God to move and to work, begging and beseeching heaven to do something on earth, because earth is a mess in and of itself. Amen. The chaos of society. Paul says, do you not realize the time? Can you not sense the seasons? Do you not know what's going on about you? Jesus in Matthew in chapter 24. As he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? In verse 4, and Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See, ye shall be not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise up against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquake in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you. And you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, because sin shall be run rampant, because the barn door has been left open, and all the stalls of sin have been let loose upon this earth, because it's going to run through your television and run through your cell phones, run through your heart and run through your homes. And because iniquity and ungodliness shall abound, not just away from God's house, but in God's house. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. That warm heart and fervent passion for Christ is placed in a freezer. And because we're surrounded by all of this ungodliness, we've called it now our friend. We've excused what used to be called sin. And now we call it social this and social that. And God looks down and he still says, it's sin. Wrong is still wrong. Unholiness is still unholiness. Some of y'all look shocked this morning. And it's because we have coddled to our ears preachers that have patted us on our ungodly hinnies and have patted us on our head that is filled with nonsense and garbage. And yet God's Spirit this morning wants to delve right through all of that, lay it asunder, and say, child of God, depart from iniquity and cling to holiness. Come unto me, he says this morning. Amen. Amen. Know the times. Hearts are cold. People will leave. And saying that is his opinion. Oh, dear sister and dear sir, with all respect within me, I am not your problem. You have one that is so much larger than I that your mind cannot outwit, your tongue cannot outtalk, neither can your heart outdeceive. There's a God in heaven that looks right through it this morning. Well, verse 42 of that same chapter. Watch, therefore. We have a security team. They watching this morning. You say, oh, well, we don't have it because of that which would happen all the time. We have it for that once in a lifetime thing that would challenge and change us as a church and as you as an individual. Watching and walking. Going around and communicating. Checking and seeing. Keeping an eye on what's happening all around us. Noticing the signs of this behavior. Signs of that behavior. Law enforcement men in here this morning, they look for things that didn't even cross my mind. Pastor, did you notice this? Or pastor, did you notice that? And I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, I did not. But they've been trained to have a watchful eye. And child of God, what the devil has stolen from the church house is we don't watch anymore. Or we watch, but we take it gullibly in. And we absolutely believe that Bruce Almighty was part of the deity. That Evan Almighty, well, he helped Noah out on the boat, amen. Literally had that happen. We gullibly drank all this in and boy, we're in a mess. The chaos of society. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the goodman of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man cometh. O child of God, understand this, and it's not because of what Brother Keith said, we're not trying to get out of a mess. But one of the benefits of Jesus Christ coming is we're getting out of a mess. Because this society is a mess. And what we've done is so much darkness now because so many Christians have turned off their light. They don't let their light shine anymore. We're not going to be different anymore. We don't want to be talked about anymore. You understand this? You can never make a difference if you're never different. Are y'all with me, man? Be alert to the chaos of society. Be alert to the conditions of the saints. That now, he says, it's high time to awake out of sleep. It's going to nod off a little bit for Jesus. Going to take a little nap. Going to take a little break. Going to ease up a little bit. Going to take a step back. Be careful taking a step back, because if you've ever been on the farm, you're allowed to step back right into something. Amen. And that's what Christians are doing. We're just going to take a step back. Going to take a step back. Going to take a step back. Going to ease up on this and going to lessen up on this and loosen up on this. Boy, can you hear the barn door opening? Can you hear the sin rustling in the stalls, kicking against them batter boards there, wanting to be loosed into the pasture of this world? Can you hear it this morning? Because it's going to run through society. And if you don't think it's going to stop off at my house and your house, you've been deceived, child of God. Condition of the saints is that many are sleeping. He says it's high time. He says it's a specific time. Right now, you need to make a decision. Right now, you need to decide for your life. Sir, may I gently say this? I've got a bad feeling that I'm coming across like an SOS pad, and I do not mean to. But sir, I need to humbly say that. Lead your family. Lead your family. It's not my job to lead your family. I'm not your wife's spiritual leader. I'm not your kid's spiritual leader. I'm your pastor. But sir, lead your family. And all the men should say amen right there. Mama is full of wisdom. You need to listen to Mama. If you've ever been around my counseling, you've ever been around my teaching, I have the highest of respect and honor for ladies. But sir, it's about time that you took some of the leadership role that Mama's been having to carry for your home. It's time you took it back. Now, if you snatch it back from Mama this morning and she slaps you, that's just because you were silly dumb. And there's a way to ask Mama, and there's a way to talk to Mama. You go ahead and push Mama around and just jerk it from her. She's going to look at you and go, no, 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 big boy, I earned this, you haven't. And that's the problem with some of the men in America today. They've not earned the right for their wife to follow them. And the wife has stepped all over them, and they're even proud of it. Families are raised where the young men have no backbone, have no leadership, have no fortitude. We've got girls being raised up that want to be drill sergeants, want to be back talkers, want to be belligerent, and they think it's cool. You go ahead and take that attitude of a guy that won't lead and a girl that won't stop, and you've got a disaster on your hands. I realize I'm paddling down the stream by myself. No, I understand that. I understand that this isn't popular, but let me just ask you this. If America keeps on getting what we got, where are we going? Hey, how's this thing working for you? How's it going? You want to get mad at me this morning and stow up the Holy Ghost of God? Want to go ahead and get all crimped up in your spirit? That's fine, but how's it going for you? Go ahead and let me be your lightning rod of excuse this morning, but how's it going for you? How's that marriage going for you? How's that relationship going for you? How's that self-esteem going for you? How's it going for you? And if somebody doesn't stand up in the churches of America today and just be a voice from the Word of God when it comes to these types of things, we're going to continue to get what we've been getting, and it ain't been good. Can somebody say amen? Amen. So, Mama, you need to look at your band this morning and say, you my hero. Not you my zero. But see, we're even proud that we can look at him and say that to him. If you think it's cute this morning that you look at your man and call him a zero, just understand it ain't cute. But you done beat him down so much. You done ridiculed him so much. You done embarrassed him so much. You done run your mouth so much that he actually feels like a zero now. And what you need is some Holy Ghost encouragement this morning. You need to get inside his life. You need to stop finding everything that's wrong with him. And you need to build your man up to where he can leap tall buildings in a single bound. He can stick his bird chest out and take on some bullets. Are you hearing me this morning? If you start letting your man act like a man, you might have a man at home. Well, thank you, preacher. God bless you. But we're sleeping. And while we've been sleeping, they've been playing nasty tricks on the house of God. And we woke up. We put our hand on our face and got shaving cream all over it. The funny thing is it's not funny. Because the world's looking at the church of the Lord Jesus Christ like we're a bunch of spineless, worthless, can't get nothing done, can't go forward, can't work together. Boy, them Christians, I don't know if Christians scare hell anymore. Because most of God's people, if they're not careful, live more like they're going to go to hell than they're going to go to heaven. Are you with me this morning? The society, the saints. He says, you wake up, get out of your sleep, shake all of that lethargy off your life. You say, well, I think I'm going to get a little stirred up this morning, preacher. Glory to God. Even if it's in the wrong direction, ma'am, get stirred up this morning. Get stirred up a little bit where the Holy Ghost of God can work in your life and God can tell you what to do rather than you telling everybody else what to do. Sir, get a little stirred up this morning. I don't want you busting me in the mouth, and I don't want you to tackle me going to my truck. But I hope you get stirred up a little bit that there's a little man oomph inside you that says, glory to God, I'm going to lead my family. I'm going to love God. I'm going to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ and not having bowed down to everything and everybody but the one I should have bowed down to, and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen. Be alert. Number two on your outlines. Be active. Be active. Once you wake up, start getting on it. Get something done. God. You ever woke up and went from the bed to the sofa? I will humbly say this. That is called vacation. But if your whole life is going from the bed to the sofa and you wonder why you don't get anything done for God, the slothful man desireth, he has nothing. The diligent shall be made fat. There's activity within the child of God's life. I don't know the Bible. Because you don't read it. You say, preacher, what's wrong with you? Nothing. Not a thing. Sin got me sort of tore up. But outside of that, I'm good. But we got to have some activity in our life. You got to read the Bible. You got to pray. There's got to be spiritual discipline in your life. Be active. The urgency, urgency because of the urgency. People look at me like I'm so weird, and I know I'm weird. I know that. I know that I've scared our visitors to death, and I just want to humbly say I'm a nice guy. Amen, church. That was a paid endorsement. But I'll be honest with you. I try to stifle it. But sometimes, I'm going to be honest with you, it is tearing me up inside. I feel like my heart has become liquid lava. Our city is going to a devil's hell. Our country is on a fast track to total depravity. Burkina Faso, I'm glad what you're doing. But they're not saved. The Ivory Coast, Ghana, they're not saved. They're not saved. And I know I don't want to freak you out, but yeah, I have a hard time. I have a hard time looking at a globe. I have a hard time looking at a map. I have a hard time looking at the world without my soul just absolutely melting out of me. Because they're damned. They're condemned already. They're not saved. And there's grandmothers, and there's fathers, and there's mothers, and there's teens, and there's young adults. They're dying without Christ. You say, preacher, what is the problem? The problem is that we don't have more time. We have less time than we've ever had to do anything for Christ. And so, young people, you listen. If you're going to give Christ your life, then today's a good day. Don't waste any more of your days. Don't waste any more of your time. Don't waste any more of your breath on things that will not matter. You fill your life, your heart with passion for the Lord Jesus Christ, and you make today matter. Because tomorrow may never get here. Urgency. Urgency within our lives. We've been duped into a sleep, swayed into sin. Devil's playing his little harp, leading us as a Pied Piper further and further and further away from the good things of God. Urgency. Do you feel any urgency this morning? Is there any urgency to reach the lost? Is there any urgency to do something for God? Is there any urgency within you this morning? If the only urgency is getting to lunch, may God help us. There's got to be an urgency to win souls. There's got to be an urgency to teach and to train and equip. There's got to be an urgency because it's high time. The night is far spent. The day is almost at hand. Active because of the urgencies. Be active against the hindrances. Cast off the works of darkness. I wonder sometimes if it would not behoove us more as a church to have the invitation first rather than last. Casting off those things that hinder us and weigh us down, get us away from God. I humbly ask you this question. When is the last time in a church service after the Word of God was preached that you dealt with God? When is the last time after the Word of God was preached that you took the time to let the Word of God deal with you and you dealt with the Word of God? Have all the messages, have they always been for someone else? Does God have such little care for your spiritual life that He never stops by where you're seated? Is there so little concern from the holy, but He never convicts you? Has church just turned into us performing? Perform, song leader. Perform, puppet pastor. Perform, forest missionary. Perform for us. And punch our ticket at 12. Or is there more to this thing? Is there a sovereign holy God that dwells and reigns within the heavens? And does He care about man upon the earth? We can be so bent toward the schedules on our smartphones that we never schedule the Spirit of God to stop off and work in our hearts and lives. Sum it up, preacher. Finish it up. Because we've got things to do today. And we'll miss out on the greatest thing that you and I need to do. And that is to allow the Word of God to change our life. Is there no sin that He would point out in a life today? Rather easy to point it out in everyone else, but not see it within our own life. Is there not a call in the middle section? Will there not be a call of God on a life today to do something for Him? A wife? A husband? A child? A teen? Will there be no speakings of the divine within the hearts of those that say they're children of God, children of God within this section? Will God just totally leave you alone this day? Is it He's not speaking? Or am I not hearing? Lost. 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 not saved, not born again, not regenerated, not having the Spirit of God, not having heaven. God, help us that we can go through a service. God, help us that we can go through the Word of God. God, help us that we would go through an invitation, lost and damned without Christ. And we have so lied to ourselves. We are good. We so lied to ourselves that hell is probably not that real. And we all know that God's not that mean. Lost. Is your family saved? Are your friends saved? Do they know Christ? Are you saved? Do you know Christ as your Savior? Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Do you know for sure that heaven is your eternal home? I applaud this man for going to Burkina Faso, and we pray for you as you fly out Wednesday. But God, help us to act like we're concerned about Burkina Faso. And we're not about uncles, aunts, nephews, nieces, sons, daughters. And the last part of Romans 13. Paul is lifting up his hands and waving them as a warning sign. And he says to them, be ye also ready. For in such an hour as you think not, Jesus Christ is coming back. Anybody ever had, and I'm way over and you've been way gracious. Anybody ever had the mom and dad say, we're coming home at 10. We're coming home at 11. Maybe left you with a pushover for a babysitter. I know that never happened to y'all. I'm just making this up as I go. Anybody ever did anything they weren't supposed to be doing? Like running through the kitchen with those swinging Western doors and hit one of them and break them off the hinges. I didn't do that. And my brother. You remember that impending feeling while you're trying to fix what you've broken because you did what you weren't supposed to? And all of a sudden, some of y'all weren't raised country. You don't know what it sounds like for a car to drive up a mile-long gravel driveway. Y'all with me? Let me just tell you this. When you're done wrong and that car starts coming out of that driveway, you can hear every mile, every step, And it get closer. Anybody ever got in trouble trying to fix something you weren't supposed to be playing with and you broke it and you're trying to fix it, and the faster you try to fix it, the more you broke it? Anybody ever been sort of squatting on their haunches there trying to fix that thing that's laying on the floor? And Daddy walks in. Does anybody remember the look on Dad's face? Anybody remember what came next? There's something about mom and dad coming home early. And I fear for some of God's children, Jesus can come home early. And you've lived your life saying you've always had more time. But if you listen real close, and I don't know the day, I don't know the hour, I wouldn't dare speculate. But Brother Pete, I think we could say this, because a mile-long driveway in the country, that is a long way. I would say this, Brother Pete. I would say if the children in God's house has been playing around, would take a listen, just real close-like. Oh, they may not be able to see the headlights because the pine trees are blocking in the curve. But if God's children listen real close this morning, they'd be able to hear the gravel crackling under the tires coming, bringing the Lord Jesus Christ home. Are you ready? Are you ready? Say, preacher, I'm a little concerned that you all stirred up. Can I say this without being a smart aleck? You're concerned that I'm a little stirred up. And I got to be real honest, I'm probably a little concerned that you're not. We say we hold the truth. I guess I'm just a little exasperated in my soul. Not mad at anybody. Well, I love this church. Not leaving, not planning on going nowhere. I really love you. But I think there's just a little bit of exasperation in me this week. that if we're not careful, we live like there's no return of Jesus Christ. And we live fatalistically that what will be, and we roll over and we play dead. You know what Paul told him to do? He said, and how many of you had a daddy do this in the summertime, thought you were going to sleep in all summer because you out of school? How many of y'all the first day after school let out, daddy had a... It wasn't a 100-acre garden, but Brother Jason Muslett sure enough felt like a 100-acre garden, amen? And that first day, you thought, man, I'm going to sleep in. How many of y'all had daddy come in, kick your bed, look at you and go, boy, them rows ain't going to weed themselves. It's time to get to dear Jesus. I pray that you'd kick our bed a little this morning. I pray that you'd wake us up. I pray that you stir in our hearts. I pray that you stir in our lives. And I pray that before it's everlasting too late, I pray that we would do something for you. I pray, Father, that we would cast off all the unrighteousness and we would put on the armor of light, because we surely are in a warfare. My soul, we are in a warfare. And the price are people. Dear Jesus, would you help me to be the right kind of preacher I need to be? Would you help my heart be full of love and my mouth full of truth? I pray that the Spirit of God would work in each heart and work in each life. Dear Jesus, we individually, we take this moment and we ask, what do you want from my life? Could I humbly, as heads are bowed and eyes are closed, could I humbly, you've been very gracious, thank you. Could I humbly ask you, quick in your mind, now wake your mind back up. Don't let the music put you to sleep. Don't let it be an invitation, put you into lethargy. Would you, with a quickened mind right now, would you say, Jesus, what do you want from my life? God, what change do I need to make in my life? Father, show me, guide me, convict me, help me. The coming of Christ, our salvation, is nearer than it's ever been. Dear Jesus, help me to be found ready. 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 I'm not going to have you raise your hands and put them down. I'm going to have us all stand in a moment. I'm going to give you a verse that if the Holy Spirit of God is working in your heart and life and there's things in your pew or at this altar that you need to deal with God on, then I humbly make that possible that you might be able to do what God wants you to do. But it's got to be you and God. It's got to be you and God. What does God want to do in your heart and in your life? As you stand, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Would you do that? Standing, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Brother Keith is going to start singing what we call a hymn of invitation, a song during this time where we invite you to respond to what God is speaking to you in your heart at a place of prayer down front. As Brother Keith begins to sing, I invite those that are children of God, I invite you to come and I invite you to pray. These are coming. How about you this morning? How about you this morning?
Oh God.
Now we got some folks that are hurting this morning. We do. Maybe you come, get around them, love on them, pray with them. Go ahead, Christian, find you somebody, pray with them. Are you saved? Ma'am, are you saved? Sir, are you saved? Do you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior? Do you know for sure that heaven is where you're going to spend your eternity? Do you know that? Do you know that? Maybe right now, you say, preacher, I don't know for sure that heaven's where I'm going to spend my eternity, but I'm concerned this morning. If that's you, would you just look at me? Would you just look at me? I don't know where I'm going to spend my eternity. I don't know. Would you let us show you from the Bible? Would you let us show you from the Bible? If that be you this morning and you be shown in a private place, not to embarrass, to show you in a private place from the Word of God, what the Bible teaches about how you can know for sure that heaven's your eternal home. Right now, could I invite you to come and meet me down front? Would you mind doing that? You want to know for sure that heaven's where you're going to spend your eternity. There are some decisions to mess around with. This is not one of those.
From
heaven. If you want to know, I invite you to come. I just invite you to come. Let us show you from the Bible. The Bible teaches about salvation. These are praying this morning. Brother Keith's going to sing through one more verse. If you need to be seated, I totally understand. God's stirring, God's moving His heart. Some folks need some help this morning. They need some strength from God. They need something from God this morning. I want to give them time. There's some folks that don't know Christ this morning. I want to just beg you, please let somebody show you from the Bible. But the Bible teaches about knowing for sure that heaven is your eternal home. I'll never apologize for that. Your soul is worth that. Jesus Christ has died for you. You sense that conviction this morning? Do you sense that conviction this morning? That's God loving on you. Come to Him.
Fill me with fire where once I burned with shame. Grant my desire to
get Brother Doug to close us in a word of prayer, if you wouldn't mind.
I'm just going to say, Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to You this morning, God, we just thank You so much, God, for loving us. And Lord, my prayer is this morning, Lord, You'd forgive us, Lord, to getting relaxed and, Lord, not doing the things that You have us to do, Lord, in our lives, God, that we could be the witnesses of what we ought to be. Lord, every time we start to just relax, God, just remind us, Lord, of those souls that are on the way to hell. And God, that we could be a witness to in little things, in little ways, little things we could say or do, Lord, because people are watching us and everything that we do. And God, help us, Lord, to be what You'd have us to be. Lord, I pray this morning, God, for the ones that are not able to be here today, Lord, the ones that are sick. God, we lift them up to You, Lord. We have several in our church, Lord, that have operations. And God, we pray that You be with them. Lord, we thank You, Lord, for our missionaries, God, as was mentioned this morning, all around this world. God, places that we can't go, Lord, but just a little bit we can do, Lord, for You. And God, for those lost souls, Lord, that are over there that we can't reach ourselves. But Lord, someone else goes and reaches them, Lord. God, I pray now that You go with us as we go our separate ways. God, You just keep us safe. Bring us back tonight. In Jesus Christ's name we ask. Amen.
Amen. Love you. You're dismissed.